Hey, welcome to another Orbiter 2010 video. Recording this video Saturday, November 15th, 2014. This video is going to be the second in a short series that I'm doing. Probably won't have more than two parts, maybe three. Starting off on the moon in the XR2, and I'm just going to rendezvous with a space station that I have in orbit around the moon, the very cool ESS. So if you haven't seen part one and you want to kind of get caught up on what's happening, go back and check out that video, then come back here. Let's resume the flight. Let me hit a camera switch button here. There we go. And so this is exactly where I left off at the end of the last video. I got up into orbit and I'm more or less circularized. I'm kind of chasing the ESS at this point. It was almost just purely dumb luck that I was almost able to rendezvous with it on my first pass up to, or one of my passes up toward Apoapsis, without even doing any sync orbit or transects or anything. And if that had been the case, it would have just been purely dumb luck. You know, I certainly couldn't do any calculations like that in my head. So where we left off at then is that I'm trailing the ESS by, you know, a little bit, and I'm a little bit higher than the ESS on this side of my orbit. And I think I've decided that I'm going to use my Apoapsis as the rendezvous point. Let me just quite take a quick look. Yeah, it wouldn't be bad to do it here because I'm kind of at the terminator between sunlight and night side. So if I rendezvous here around this area, then I'm not going to be like flying in the pitch black of night. And I always like that. So let's go ahead then and kind of warp time forward, get over to the periapsis. Before I do that, let me set up my navigation equipment. Let me go to ComNav, Control-I, and bring up the vessel. And we're going to select ESS off the list. Set that kind of over here. Pull this down, make it larger so I can see everything. Now, first thing I want is the transponder, and that's going to be 13220. That's the long-range radio frequency so that when I'm, you know, several hundred kilometers away, I can still get a signal. So I'm going to bring that down to 132.20. And there's my long range. Now I'm going to set up one or two of these for some of these docking ports that are available. You can see there's actually something docked on docking port 3, so we're not going to be able to use that one. But let's see if, let's just do one and two. That'll give me two choices when I get there. So let's go. That's going to be 113.45. Eh, let's just do that one. All right, there we go. So we have that set up. So now when I get close, I can change my nav over to nav 1. That'll give me the long range, and I'll have an idea of how far away I am from the target. Okay, but for now, let's go over to periapsis. And we're going to bring down the high side of our orbit. We're going to bring it down about 19 kilometers, it looks like, 21, something like that. So around the moon we go. Where we stop, nobody knows. No, I know. We're going to stop at periapsis. Okay, there we are, basically at periapsis, more or less.
Rotation.
Let's get rotated, and since I happen to be pretty much facing the prograde position, I'm just going to go ahead and rotate prograde. But instead of applying thrust forward, which would raise the other side of my orbit, I'm going to thrust backwards or retro, and that will have the net effect of lowering the orbit on the other side. Let's get a little closer to periapsis. And I remember that I still have the retro doors open, so I'll take advantage of that and use those. They're quite a bit more powerful than the translation. So I want to bring my altitude down on the other side. So periapsis, I want my apoapsis to be right there. Let's bring it down just a touch more.
Translation.
Use translation for that. Let's go with that. So now at worst, I'm only 1 or 1.5 kilometers difference in altitude on that side. Let's bring back up sync orbit. Now, I don't want to make any change now that would affect my altitude, because my altitude is currently, it's currently matching really closely what the altitude of the ESS is at this point. I can tell the ESS apoapsis is here, and we're saying we're basically going to rendezvous over here, so I can tell that this is its downhill ride, but it's only going downhill by 1 kilometer, so by the time we get to here, it's going to be at like 1,962 kilometers, 0.8 or something. It's going to be really close. Let me also bring up a line plane, and as I'm coming up to the descending node, actually I should have took care of it there at the ascending node, but I'll do it as I get over to the descending node. I'm going to clean up that last little bit of difference in relative inclination. It's not really necessary, but the fact that we're going to cross the node, there's really no reason not to do it. And all it's going to do is basically just make sure that when we do rendezvous with the ESS, am I passing it? That kind of sucks. Deal with that on the next ride around, I guess. Actually, we'll take care of that at apoapsis. Here, what I'll end up doing, I'll have to raise my periapsis up high enough so that I'm higher than the ESS, so that I'll slow down. And that's actually going to have an interesting effect we'll have to take into account, and I'll explain that when we get there. But for now, let's clean up that last little bit of relative inclination. Coming up to the node, we'll get right up on top of it, and we'll just use translation. And the ascending node's anti-normal, which means we would thrust this way, so we're going to thrust this way up a bit. Let's get a little closer.
Rotation.
Translation. I'm going to thrust 2, which is going to push the vessel up just a touch. And that basically nulls out the difference. Okay, we'll go with that. So now I'm coming up to apoapsis. Let me get into the, what's closer?
Rotation.
Retrograde or prograde? Retrograde's closer. So let's go retrograde. And what I have to do is I have to raise the other side of my orbit, because I'm now in front of the ESS a little bit, and I need it to catch up to me. So I need my orbital period to take a little bit longer than the orbital period of the ESS. But this also means that if I do that, currently, I'm at apoapsis. I'm currently at the highest point of my orbit, and I'm telling the system, I'm telling sync orbit that this is where I want to rendezvous. I want to rendezvous at my apoapsis. But if I raise the other side of my orbit higher than my present position, what's going to end up happening is that my apoapsis is now going to be my periapsis. So I have to tell sync orbit, after I do this little bit of a burn, I'm going to have to tell sync orbit, well, now I need to rendezvous at my periapsis instead of my apoapsis. It's still the same position in space, but now, since I've raised the other side of my orbit higher than this point, then this point is now going to become my periapsis. So let's get closer to the apoapsis. I'm currently facing retrograde, which means I'm going to need to burn backwards, so I'll use the retro engines for that. And because if I want to raise the other side of my orbit, I need to burn prograde into my position. But if I'm facing backwards, then burning prograde would actually lower the other side of my orbit, and that's not what I want. Let's get facing this position. We just passed apoapsis. Okay, let's raise up the other side of the orbit now. And watch what happens when it crosses that yellow line. You're going to see that my apoapsis and periapsis trade places. Go a little bit more. Okay, I'm now there they go. Now my periapsis is where I'm at right now, because the other side's now a little bit higher. Okay, now I want to decide. Let me bring up sync orbit.
Translation.
Can kind of go ahead and take advantage of the DT min here. So it's basically what I'm looking at now, although I have to change this to periapsis. There we go. Wait, ship's periapsis. I almost forgot to do that. Okay, so now at my periapsis, I'm at 1,963 kilometers above the moon. You can see that's really close to what the apoapsis and periapsis is for the ESS. So we're going to be at the same altitude. And according to this MFD, we have a difference now in velocity. It's only 15 meters per second, which is much more realistic. It's not as fun, but it's more realistic. I'm just trying to make sure that my DT min is as low as it can be. And it's gonna get worse if I keep messing with it, so I'm just gonna leave it right there where it is. And now we're going to have to go around. We're gonna pass this point, and then we're gonna have to go around a couple more times. So let's go ahead and make that happen. Let's time warp. And each time I go around, and when I pass the apoapsis and periapsis, I want to check a couple of things. So right now, what I'm gonna check, since the ESS is approaching this point, I can make a mental note. Its current altitude right here is 1,963, and that's exactly what my periapsis is. There would be some additional precision in there if I could have more decimal points, but that's good enough. So currently, right now, you can see the ESS is passing my periapsis, my green dot. This is exactly where the ESS is at right now, this very second. And right now, this very second, the altitude of the ESS is 1,963. So altitude's good. Don't have to worry about that. The other thing I want to check is I go around. I want to make sure that my relative inclination stays at 0.00. Make sure that doesn't slip for any reason, but I don't think it will. The other thing I can check, since I have to go around a couple of orbits, every time I get back to my periapsis, I want to check my DT min again, especially on the last orbit around. Because you can see right now it's 0.21. That's fine, probably, maybe. But I would like that to be 0.00. And I have time to make that happen. I still have a couple of orbits to go. So I'm going to put in some time warp. And I've learned my lesson. Be patient with your time warp. If you go at 10,000, it will completely ruin your day. You can see the DT min slipping there substantially, but that tends to happen when you have non-spherical gravity sources enabled, with like I do. But you can see as we come back around, it gets more stable back to where we want it. But as I approach my periapsis right now, I want to check the DT min at my periapsis. So right now,
rotation.
And I want to bring that down to 0.00, and it will go up and down, up and down, up and down. But every time I get close to periapsis, it should be steady if I get it set now. And I'm past periapsis, so I'm just trying to take care of that quickly, using a bit more fuel to rotate than I would normally.
Translation.
Okay, we'll go with that. We've got it all the way down to 0.07, which is very good. Relative velocity between myself and the target is only 10 meters per second, so we're approaching it incredibly with a very, very slow. We're going to have to go around a full orbit again. So we'll go ahead and do that. Relative inclination is zero. One thing I should have noted was the altitude, but I think the altitude's fine. The altitudes are very stable. So we're going to go around at 1,000, and no more than 1,000. I've discovered on many flights that 10,000 just really messes things up. Even 1,000 probably isn't the best. But so as we're coming around, coming up to periapsis, going to watch things here. Okay, we're getting very close, coming back to a slower amount of time warp. And you can see the DT min now is 0.10. And now I want to get that really close to zero, because I only have one more orbit to go around.
Rotation.
So let's get rotated to prograde. Okay, there's prograde. Now, right as I approach periapsis.
Translation.
Get the translation ready. So we're 20 seconds out. Let's go a little. There we go.
Rotation. Translation.
And we're just going to do the smallest amount of correction. Actually putting in even a little bit of plane change at this point. There we are, 0.00. That did send my plane off a little bit, but I think probably having the DT min lower is probably more important. So now we're going to rendezvous with the ESS on the next time we come around. So for this last one, I'm actually going to be extra patient. I'm going to use 100 time warp. And the reason the time warp is is not perfect is has to do, it's a technical thing, it has to do with a concept called stepping. And if you want to read more about that, you'll have to talk to somebody that knows more than I do. But essentially, when you use time warp, the statistics, the information, the calculations, they get increasingly inaccurate every time you time warp another step. So when you go from 10 to 100, the calculations are slightly less accurate than they were at 10x, and 10x is slightly less accurate than 1x, and probably in theory 1x is slightly less accurate than 1/10 per second, but that would be ridiculous to use orbiter with that little bit of time warp. But when you go from 1000 to 10,000, it gets really bad. Now, it's not a problem when you're doing interplanetary, you know, when you get out away from Earth and you're cruising at a 10,000 or 100,000 time warp, though, that's fine. But when you're in or around a body, 1000x seems to be as tolerable as orbiter is. And I don't know really what you could do to make that better. I don't know if a supercomputer would handle it any better than a regular computer or not. But that's just a technical point, and for the most part, it really doesn't matter. Most people's computers are able to handle it.
5,000.
Wow, we're only 5,000 kilometers away from our target. I wasn't even paying attention, so let me bring up the docking HUD, and I'm down to 10x for a moment. Let me navigate over to Nav1 and put that information up on the HUD. Okay, there we go. Now we'll go continue our time warp.
4,000.
And now I'm not even worried about this stuff or orbit MFD. I'm really just 100% focused now on the nav. What I can do now is I can come back to regular time.
Rotation.
Switch over to rotation, and I want to find where the ESS is actually at. So what I want to do for a moment is I want to power these off for just a second, and actually there it is. I can see it right there. And I just want to rotate to face it. Now let me go ahead and turn this side back on, and I'm going to continue time warping. What I want to watch is I want to make sure that I'm continually getting closer to it and not farther away. And I know that I'm getting closer because the DST says that I'm getting closer, but I can also see the relative velocity. When it's yellow like this, this is how fast I'm closing in on the ESS. I'm closing in currently at 1/6 of a meter per second. And you can see that's slightly going down. Eventually this will reach zero, and this will turn green, and then this will start counting back up. When that happens, it means you're no longer getting closer, and you are, at that point, in fact, getting farther away. And if that happens, what you need to do then is eliminate any difference in velocity so that you're not getting farther away from the target. So I'll kind of show you what I mean here as we get closer. So you can see that number is coming down quickly. So the closest that I'm going to get is about 2 kilometers. Let's bring the relative velocity all the way to zero. Let's actually stop it just a second early. There we go. So now you can see I'm still getting closer to the ESS, but only by, you know, this very, very small amount.
Translation. Rotation.
Let me rotate toward the ESS. And I just want to make this point in case anybody has any problems rendezvousing. So you may find that you get to this point, and I found this early on, and this isn't like an absolute beginner guide, but I'll say this anyway. You get to this point and you see that you're getting closer and you're thinking, yay, I'm getting closer. And then you just kind of continue going. And what ends up happening is this, okay? And you're in this, because you don't know about this, you get closer and now we're slowing down, but we're still technically getting slightly closer, and you're just waiting. You're waiting and waiting and waiting to get right up to it. But now you hit this point where you are as close as you're gonna get, and now you're actually getting farther away, and then the people don't know what to do. They don't understand that, okay, well now I just simply need to thrust a little bit, not using main engines, but just thrust a little bit with translation toward the object so that I don't have my velocity counting down. So then they'll go forward at 10, 100, 1,000 or something, and then they'll just see the object floating away and they don't know what to do about it. happened to me all the time when I was brand new to orbiter. But that's the point. Now you can see that our distance is increasing. So if we don't make some kind of correction here at this point, we're never going to rendezvous. We're just going to, it's going to get farther away. Very simple fix. All I want to do is rotate so that I'm facing straight at the object that I'm going toward. Switch to translation.
Translation.
And now I want to translate toward that object. Now you can see what's happening is my relative velocity. So in other words, myself compared to the ESS, I'm now getting closer. And you can see the distance is now coming back down. It's a very simple fix. And what I like to do is translate until the velocity vector, that's this guy, is all the way on top of the ESS. Because basically, like I've said in the hundreds of flights probably by now, wherever the velocity vector is pointing, that's where you are going. So if my velocity vector is over here, I'm going that way. And the ESS is over there. So going there when the ESS is over there doesn't make a lot of sense. So put the velocity vector right where you want to go. And pick a speed at which you want to close the distance. I think 5, 10, something like that is usually good. You don't want to put in too much. But on the other hand, you don't want it to be too slow either. But if I'm approaching at, you know, 0.01 or something, I'll get there eventually, assuming that I don't end up drifting away, but it'll take forever. But if I close in at, you know, 10 meters or something like that,
2000.
Then I'll get there much more quickly. You can see the distance counting down. Don't want to overdo it, because as I've also said in a lot of flights, every meter per second that you put in, you have to take back out. So you don't necessarily want to put in a lot of extra velocity going forward, because then you're just going to have to take it all back out. So here we are, approaching the ESS. And I don't know if I'll have time to, I guess I'll probably have time to finish the rendezvous. So let's turn on the APU and open the nose cone so that we can be prepared for that. So I hit Control A, Control K, now you can see the nose cone coming open. A little bit of time warp to speed up that animation. Control A to turn that back off. And I'm gonna try to get in there a little more quickly because I don't want the video to go over 30 minutes. So let me switch navigation. Now that I'm close enough to the ESS, I can switch navigation over to nav 2, and nav 2 is where I have the frequency set up for the docking port. Hit the HUD button and it shows me that corridor.
1000.
You can see the corridor is actually over there. So let me actually use a little bit of reverse thrust, slow down a little bit. And I'm going to move the velocity vector over this way. And
rotation.
Rotate a little bit, and I'll explain why I'm doing that.
900.
The port that I want to dock to is over here on this side. This, if I were to fly straight through that corridor, the port is somewhere over there. So if I fly straight toward the ESS here, I'm going to miss the port. So I'm going to move the...
Translation.
Going to move the velocity vector out to this point, which gives me time to get in front of the port and then get oriented and fly back in. You could put the velocity vector even here, and in fact, let's do that. I would say, you know, people that are kind of getting newer probably want to have your velocity vector back here, or maybe even all the way back there, depending on how unfamiliar you are. But the better you get, the more experience you get, you're going to be able to get closer and closer. In the interest of time, let's go ahead and time warp forward.
7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 200.
As long as that velocity vector is right there,
100,
I'm happy.
75.
Okay, now I want to come out of time warp, and I want to slow things down a little bit.
50,
and I want to
rotation.
Rotate around so I can see the ESS. And while I'm doing that, I'm also going to take into consideration my
40.
Dials here, so to speak.
Translation.
Looks like I'm actually missing the ESS to the other side a little bit, so let me fix that. But now I just need to sort of hover down and around. You can see this is where I am, that's the port that I'm going to, so I just have to translate down, over, rotate, rinse, repeat, and we're good. This navigation information, or this docking port's telling me how I need to be oriented with the port in terms of left, right, up, down, and then also in terms of rotation, like pitch, yaw, and roll. This tells me both of those things. Right now I can't tell where I need to be in terms of pitch, roll, yaw, because this X is missing. The X will come into view as I get closer to the port. So let me time warp over there.
30.
And this crosshair is telling me how my orientation looks in terms of up, down, left, right, forward, backward. Okay, we're pretty much getting more or less in front of it.
Rotation.
So let's rotate. Let's get a little further down. Now you can see I'm actually dropping below the port a little bit.
Translation.
So if I want to prevent that from happening, I can just translate up a touch. And I can tell that I'm below it because this X, or this yellow crosshair, is above the line. If it's above the line, then that means I'm below and I need to go up a little bit. So I can just put in a touch of translation. And you don't want to overdo it. Now,
rotation.
I could probably rotate pretty far around. And now you can see that X coming into view. The X tells me if I'm rolled, or if I'm pitched, or if I'm yawed or something. So I'm going to bring things around where they need to be. This helps me know where my orientation is with regards to my roll. If it's white and it's facing up, then you're rolled correctly. If it's red and if it's off to the side, that means you have roll in the wrong direction.
Translation.
Translate forward a little bit, so I'm moving toward it. Translate this way, and in the interest of time, again, I'm just going to kind of go through this last part pretty quickly.
Rotation.
And it's not an absolute beginner guide video anyway, so.
20. Translation. 15.
I did not radio over to the ESS to tell them to stop rotating, but it doesn't appear that that's going to be too much of a problem.
Rotation.
I can feel that I need to rotate this way, I think.
10. 9. Translation. 8. 7. 6. 5. 4. 3. 2.
Concentrating,
1.
Concentrating. Don't blow it, don't blow
Contact.
It.
Contact.
Contact. There we go. And I made it in under 30 minutes on the second part.
Capture and hard dock. Congratulations.
All right, so that was just a fun little flight that I wanted to do to get myself back into orbiter, and also to help make sure that I don't run out of video content. I'm very proud of the fact that I've been uploading videos now. At least one video per week, and oftentimes many more than that. But when I get lower on content, I revert back to just doing one per week. And I've been able to keep up with that now, I think it's like 3 years. I've never missed a week yet in like 3 years. So it's almost like a goal of mine to not miss any, but it's going to happen, I think, sooner or later, unfortunately. But at least now I've got another couple of weeks covered, so I don't have to worry about it. If you like this part of the video, hit the like button down below. And if you didn't like it for any reason, that's fine. Go ahead and hit the don't like button. But two, please leave a comment one way or the other. Let me know what you think. And if you have any questions, thoughts, anything like that, leave that in the comments area below. Be sure to check the description for links. In particular, I have a FAQ. That's a frequently asked question. It's all the way at the bottom of the description. Click on that. A lot of people ask me the same stuff over and over again, such as what video recording equipment I have, what are my PC specs, all that kind of thing, what add-ons. It's all answered in the FAQ. I will see you in the next video.